we've really done some selecting. Therefore, in my book, we become queen bearers. And at this point, I generally ask how many of them are queen bearers, and virtually most of them put their hands up. So within 10 seconds or so, I've sort of changed their line of thought from what they actually thought. And it really is, folk, as simple as that. There is, folks. Now, here's a little bit of terminology and my take on it anyway. Breeding, in my book, is simple. It's assessing what you have. Got two colonies, one's better than the other. So you've immediately made a selection decision. You then, from those, select which one you want. Number one is better than number two, or the other way around. So you propagate from that one because that's the one you want, and you replace the queen in the one you don't want. That, in a nutshell, is really what I think breeding at our level is all about. So I reckon that's simple. Queen rearing is simply propagation, so producing the queens, which in a lot of instances you can get the bees to do. So that, I reckon, is simple too. But of course, what happens is, all these sex alleles and genetics and all that sort of thing. Oh, I can't stand that. Down comes the mental barrier. It's all a bit like some people saying they can't find queens. The reason they can't find queens is because they've made their mind up they can't do it. I think we get the same thing with queen rearing. So down comes the mental barrier. It seems difficult. That's probably because other beekeepers have made it appear difficult. But the bees will actually do most of it if you're cunning enough to let them do it. Now it becomes very simple. So queen rearing is, it's not a black art, not at all. There's no magic in it or anything of that nature at all. Personally, I don't think it's difficult. It needn't be, not at a basic level anyway. It's actually part of my management system because all the time I'm thinking to myself, if I've got queen cells available, I'll use them. If I've got a colony that I think probably needs requeening for whatever reason, that goes into the back of my my noddle box. And at the first opportunity, out goes that queen and in goes a replacement. So it's not something I do in a panic mode, which I know quite a lot of beekeepers do. And I don't wish to blame or criticize anyone, but I think partly this is the responsibility of beekeeping associations. And I'm a apiary manager of Whisper Green Beekeeping Association, have been for the best part of 20 years. And I try and encourage people to think, or beekeepers to think about this anyway. It's also an opportunity to improve your bees. Because if you have got some that are probably not as good as you think they are, then try and raise queens from the better ones. I think you'll find it enjoyable, and beekeeping, in my opinion, should be enjoyable. Otherwise, why do it? And it's also pretty satisfying as well to certainly have a queen raised that you've raised yourself that is doing well and better than the one that she replaced. So I'm going to show you a few things that might help you in your beekeeping and probably help you produce queens. Some of these I have in my standard presentations. So some of you probably know these anyway. One of which is the two-frame nuke, which is basically one frame of food and one frame of largely sealed brood with adhering bees. That's it. That's all that comes from bees. The rest is a few young bees. If you're going to keep them at home, you need to make sure that that the numbers are stay up. I'll talk a little bit about that later on as to how to do that. Comb or foundation. I think comb is far better because it helps these small nukes build up a lot quicker. If foundation's all you've got, then foundation's all you can use. That is really economical on bees. and you may well be at the small scale level encouraged to probably buy apiteas and many nukes, not just apiteas. And one of the reasons, or one of their best selling points, is that there's a small number of bees used. Well, in this case, we're only using really a frame of bees and a little bit of brood. And in some cases, it can actually help the colony because it might delay swarming for a time. So it's really economical on bees. I'm going to show you a use or a couple of uses of those later. There are details of the two-frame nuke on Dave Cushman's website. And also we've got a webinar on it, the two-frame nucleus, which is easily accessible from the BIBBA website. You could probably get it online as well. I don't know. Perhaps Richard will talk about that at the end. The next one is the Patterson unit, which is I've now used for probably 25 years or so. Somebody else gave it the name, so it's not me. Not me trying to push my name in front of everybody. Basically, what it is, it's a system that puts around about four colonies into a unit. It works really well with four colonies. I'm not going to go into any great depth on this because there's information elsewhere. But bear in mind that four is within the sort of limits of most amateur beekeepers. Now, in order to keep those honey as honey producing colonies, this photograph is actually taken in the Whisper Green Apiary, by the way. And before COVID, we used to do this as a regular group. There's the four colonies. So you can see all of those, they've got quite a lot of honey on. Now, because of the various problems with queens that we have these days, I dreamt up this idea of a support colony that looks after them. So if you need something, that is where you want it. So if you want brood or a queen or something like that, you take it from that colony rather than rob, if indeed rob is the right word, one of the other colonies. So ideally, for what I'm telling you tonight, this is ideal for getting queens mated in this little colony here. You'll notice there what you might think is a double brood chamber. It isn't a double brood chamber. It's a brood chamber that's used as a super with foundation in, because I've always found that you get brood combs drawn out far, far better above a queen excluder than by putting foundation in the brood box. Now, all of this, again, is on the BIBBA. We got a webinar on that, so that covers that. This looking down on the top of that box shows you what you get. Nice straight combs, which when you extract, you get really good combs. And if you put that in a nucleus, it aids build up tremendously. So there are the three things that will be helpful for the rest of the presentation. So bees and colonies give us loads of opportunities during the season, a lot more than I can mention here, but they're giving us opportunities all the time, and it's the down to the skill of the beekeeper to try and make use of those opportunities, one of which is to improve our bees. So why will we improve bees in the first place? Well, for two reasons, really. One for the beekeeper and one for the bees, and they may not be the same, although I tend to think that there's not actually that much difference between them. Certainly from an amateur beekeeper's point of view, I think that's the case. Now, if you're into absolutely maximum production and getting the most out of your bees, then probably you wouldn't bother about improving your own local bees anyway. So as far as a beekeeper is concerned, obviously temper is an issue. We really don't want or need bad tempered bees. Now, from the bees' point of view, That doesn't matter too much, although I have to say I've removed several hundred what I term free living colonies, and if they've been in there any length of time, that is over winter, I don't think I've come across a genuine bad tempered one. I've come across one or two that are a little bit on the touchy side, but certainly nothing that couldn't be dealt with. So I don't think that's too far from what the bees have. Calmness on the comb, I think, is a really good attribute to have, because if you get bees that run around on the comb, the queens always do. Makes them much more difficult to find, so it increases the length of time of inspection and that sort of thing. And I've on many occasions I've seen queens either in feeders where they've just gone straight up and gone as far away as they could, only with a little bit of smoke in the entrance. Others outside the hive I've seen. So calmness on the comb makes handling much more pleasant. And again, I don't think I can remember a colony of bad runners in the wild. Personally, I think that's enough for most of us, because if we concentrate on those two things, what I've found is virtually everything else just drops into place. It really does, especially if you take into account bees that suit the area. But for the bees' point of view, they're interested in one thing and one thing only, that's survival of the species at a stable population. They don't want too many because, of course, that puts pressure on nest sites and on forage. Too few, and, of course, it's only going to take a bit of a disaster, like two or three bad summers, and survival extinction could be a possibility in certainly in some areas that are marginal for bees. And of course they can only do this if they suit the environment. If they don't suit the environment, then nature takes them out, full stop, no argument about it. And that of course is what we now term locally adapted, although when I started keeping bees, we didn't use the term locally adapted at all. What I have found, and I come across an awful lot of bees, in my view, a lot of them need improving, and they're probably only just kept alive by the beekeeper. Now, I think it probably does good for us to look back at what one might term free living colonies. I know some call them wild, which they may or may not be. Some call them feral, which they may or may not be. So probably free living is a sort of catch-all term. Of course, they are subject to the forces of natural selection. And natural selection can be a bit unkind. It either works or it doesn't. At least in a beekeeping colony, if you've got one that's struggling a bit, you can help it out one way or another. Nature doesn't do that. It's just out, and that is it. As I already mentioned, I removed many. And what I'm going to tell you is my experience. If they've been established for any length of time, and that is over winter, because winter is a pretty good selector for bees. They're very unlike many of the managed colonies I see. They just behave differently, and they look different as well. You certainly don't get, or I have never seen, any of these bright yellow queens that I see in managed colonies or in queen suppliers videos or websites or anything like that. So certainly a queen like that I've never seen in the wild if it's been there over winter. Yes, if it's just gone in there, yes, absolutely fine. Now I can usually tell because if I come come across a swarm with a queen like this, I know it's come from a, or I'm as certain as I can be, it's come from a managed colony somewhere. Workers are mainly dark. You certainly don't get the light, bright lemons, as I call them. Some people call them satsumas. The yellow jobbies, they just simply don't survive. Most of those that I come across are a little bit like this. And this is one I took out of a barn early last year, I think now. Yeah, 2020. If you have a look there quite carefully, you'll see a little bit of yellow, but not very much. I think there's a yellowish one there that I spotted. But they're fairly typical of, there's another one here. They're fairly typical of what I see that I remove from trees, buildings, and that sort of thing. Just do not get the yellow ones. Drones are dark as well, and the queens are non-prolific. You don't get the great big slabs of brood that we're told we should have in a beehive. So that tells me that if nature takes them out, they are probably unsuited to the district that they're in. Okay, I'm going to have some people come and say, "Oh, I took out so and so, and they were bright yellow." They may well have done, but I'm just telling you what I've seen. Of course, I always ask a question, and those of you who know me will know that I'm always asking questions. Should we actually listen to nature? Because nature, to a degree, knows a lot better what it's doing and what's good for bees than humans do. So my approach to bee improvement is a little different than it's been for 50-some-odd years, which I've been keeping bees. As with most things in beekeeping, you need some sort of plan. Okay, you get to the bees, you have a look in the front, and you give it a bit of a smoke, and you lift a crown board, or often, oh dear, the bees have changed your plan for you. So then you've got to start thinking on the hoof and change it immediately. But at least if you go with a plan rather than not knowing what you're going to be doing, at least you've got a head start. Colony assessment is ongoing with me. I am assessing colonies all the time. Even if I go to another beekeeper, I'm thinking to myself, cool, these aren't bad bees. I wouldn't mind some of these. Or, well, I'm jolly glad I haven't got them in my apiary or anywhere near me. And it's surprising, certainly beekeepers with smallish numbers, how they think every colony of bees is like theirs. You know, wherever they are. And it's probably because they've got a smallish number of colonies and they just don't know what is available elsewhere. Culling, in my view, is important. And I've got to say the queens, because I've had so many people ask me if I mean the colony. No, I don't mean the colony. I actually mean the queen. And I got told off by somebody once saying that culling is a rather unpleasant word. I really ought to say replacement. But what I really mean is the boot treatment. I'm probably a bit more critical than most people are, but what I've found over the years is if you think there's something wrong with a queen, at the end of the day, there probably is. So go on your feelings. If perhaps you get to July or August and you think, she ain't doing too well. If she doesn't get that colony through the winter, you've lost a queen, you've lost all the bees, and you've lost all the food that you've poked into it, plus, of course, next year's crop. So it probably is sensible to be a little bit on the ruthless side, because if you don't take it out, nature will. And as with everything else in beekeeping, try to keep things simple, because if you keep things simple, you've generally got not only one get out of jail card, but you may well have several. So we need to find out what our bees are like then. So do that obviously by assessment. I do it at every inspection, as I just mentioned. I'm doing it all the time. If you're assessing something, you're measuring it. if you're measuring it, you really need to be recording it, because then you can make comparisons with either your other colonies or colonies of others, wherever they are. It could be 200 miles away. It doesn't really matter. It's always worth, in my view, looking at other people's techniques as well. So going along to the local beekeeping association sometimes is quite interesting. So attend apiary meetings if you possibly can. Not only can you look at the bees and compare them with yours, but you can also perhaps compare the handling techniques of the various people who look at the bees. So perhaps colony number 9 or whatever it is, it's in the corner, it's always placid, everyone likes handling it. If all of a sudden it gets fired up, just have a look at the way it's been handled. It may well be it's by one of these clowns who wear welding gloves, and don't bother to smoke the hive, rip everything to bits, pull the frames out without making space for them. And if the bees object, quite frankly, I think they've got a right to. So just because a colony is bad-tempered doesn't mean to say it's the bee's fault. It could well be, they could well have an awful lot of help. Working with other beekeepers, especially if you live in a sort of village situation where there's 2, 3, 4, or even half a dozen beekeepers, trying to get to know each other and get a little group going, help each other out. It not only does it help with the lifting, you know, there's a social side as well. And you can also have a look at your friends' bees, and where you might only have 2 or 3 colonies, get half a dozen beekeepers, all of a sudden there's 20, 30, perhaps even 40 colonies that you can be a part of, that you can sort of understand. It's a local beekeeping community. That's it. This is one of my colonies at the bottom of my garden. If you notice, a couple of supers on there, big, strong colony, obviously fairly early in the year. You can tell that by the vegetation, because the comfrey hasn't grown up very far. Have a look at the number of bees in the air. Very few. Very often I see beekeepers, and it could be either on their own or a local beekeeping association, with bees flying around at head height. Well, there are usually 3 reasons for that. Somebody standing in front of the hive, so blocking off the bees' return. If that's at a beekeeping association, then there's a demonstrator should have told somebody to move out of the way. It could be bad handling, or it could be the bees are bad tempered. So if you get a load of bees flying around at head height, you know there's a problem of one sort or another. Here's me, not probably the same day, but a few feet away in my apiary as well. Notice there are a few bees around there, but somebody is standing in front of the hive, look, so that's probably why. When you're handling a colony, you shouldn't get bees in the air like I very often see. Calmness on the comb. You can see straight away that these bees are calm. If they were runners, they'd probably run off the face of the comb, and they would be a great big cluster underneath, probably taking the queen with it if she was on that comb. They then drop off, and you run the risk of the cluster and the bee and the queen rather going onto the ground. So how do I select breed and cull then? And again, this is fairly well known. It wasn't until probably 20 years ago that I actually realized what I was doing. So then I've tended to put it in a bit of a graphic form so that it would help me explain it to people. But all I do and all I've ever done is really split all my bees, however many I've got, into 2 roughly equal groups. It's only a mental thing. It's not a physical thing like that row down there or that row down there. And I'll show you how I do it in a minute. And it's mental, and it's a simple way of doing things. And I call them for ease, Group A and Group B. Group A are the good group, and they're the ones that I tend to raise queens from all the time. Okay, I might take queen cells from other colonies if I'm absolutely short, but only short term. So I'm raising queens from any in that group, and I don't replace any of those. Just don't replace them. I know some people replace every year or two, but if you've got non-prolific bees, in my view, there's absolutely no need to. And then there's group B, and these are the ones that I'm constantly requeening from what I'm raising from group A, and it works an absolute treat, always has done, and I know several other people have adopted this method, and they reckon it's easy to work. So it doesn't really matter how many colonies you've got, whether it's the two that you had in the last slide or four now, or it could be even a bigger group, a bigger beekeeper, or perhaps a local beekeeping association. It really doesn't matter. So all I'm doing really is taking queen cells from any in group A, not just the best, because the best might not at the end of the day be good for raising queens from. They might not replicate in the next generation. So any of those, very rarely the same colony twice in the same year. So I want to, within reason, try to expand the gene pool if I possibly can, not narrow it down. So then I replace some of those in B group, not all of them by any means, but some of them. And then when I get one in group B that is better than the poorest one in group A, I literally just replace it and put it in the other group, and I note that down on my record sheet. So it's as simple as that. And then of course I just try again, keep going. So here's my record card, very simple. It's the management record card, and all I've got are three columns. Is the queen laying, yes or no? Is the queen clipped and marked, yes or no? Are there any queen cells, yes or no? As an experienced beekeeper, that's all I know, all I need to know to manage colonies. And then the two probably most important columns, temper and calmness. I mark out a 10. Some people just give a tick or a cross. Others have got a listing of five, and then they define what those five are, either very poor or excellent or acceptable or whatever. And then the groups that I just told you about, A and B, they are marked on the record sheet. Now, a colony can be moved from one group to another, sometimes might be even once or twice a year, especially those that are on the on the borderline. So that's one of the opportunities that they give us to improve our bees. Another one is to harvest natural queen cells. So natural queen cells, we all know about, but I personally don't think they're understood anywhere near enough. I think there's just so much negativity about natural queen cells, and everyone's told to avoid them. What do most people do when they see queen cells? And when I ask this question in a face-to-face meeting, there's usually two or three people lip reading tells me they know what usually happens. People press the panic button, and they're told that these things are nasty things, you've got to get rid of them, blah, 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 and all the rest of it. Roar them out as quick as you can without thinking about it. Please, please, please don't do that, and don't encourage anyone else to do it either. Because at start, they tell you an awful lot about the colony, the state of the colony, the state of the queen, and a little bit about what's likely to happen into the future. On top of that, they can be brilliant opportunities for requeening. So let's just look at the natural queen cells. Obviously, we've got swarm cells, which the colony is using for colony reproduction. So probably that would normally only be for perhaps 8 or 10 weeks of the summer. Longer in the south, shorter further north. Emergency cells, which are built when the queen goes absent. Now, I can tell you that in a natural situation, they are very, very rarely used, to the point that I have never, ever, well, I cannot ever remember seeing evidence of emergency cells in a free living colony. Seen plenty in managed colonies. So they are the two main sources of queen cells. There is another one, which is supersedure cells, which of course is queen replacement. But of course, they will be few and far between, really. If you can find them, use them, make use of them. But you can't really do any sort of planned queen rearing with them. Now, sadly, they are all frowned upon by some people. I have absolutely no idea. But most of the good, sound, knowledgeable beekeepers I know are more than happy to use all of these queen cells. I think, like a lot of things in beekeeping, it's just that people come into beekeeping, they read all the books, they get some ideas, which may not always be reliable, the best ones, and that's it. There's no good being frowning upon them, because bees have been using them for millions of years. So what's wrong with them? And I wouldn't mind betting that 75% of the queens in Britain and Ireland probably come from natural queen cells anyway, one way or another. And why is it that the speaker will willingly tell you to make an artificial swarm and use the queen cells when they object to using swarm cells? It just doesn't make sense to me, but a lot of things don't. So I'm saying they're good. You make your own mind up, and I'm saying let's use them, because I have done for a long time, and I'll continue to use them because they are usually very good. Now, as far as what I'm going to be talking about in the next half hour or so is concerned, I'm going to assume that the listeners and viewers will know some things. They're up to a certain standard. And they know that if you leave more than one queen cell, if the colony's in the right condition, the weather's right and that sort of thing, there's more than a chance that that colony will swarm. And I would have said certainly 80%. A chance it will swarm. So don't leave two queen cells, as some people often advise you to do. Just leave a one. An unsealed queen cell has at least 6 days before it emerges, more likely seven. I say six because bees can pinch a day or half a day and catch you unawares. If you work on six, then you're going on the cautious side. But in general, you can work on seven, I think. So from a weekend beekeeper's point of view, that works in absolutely fine. If you remove a queen from a colony, it will generally build emergency queen cells. If there's material to do it with, perhaps if they've got a maximum number of queen cells, they might not. But in general, assume that they will build emergency cells. When they build emergency cells, they prefer new comb rather than old, and that is presumably because it's easier for them to chew down to build the comb, or even on the edge. And you can get some very good emergency cells on the edge of a comb, especially if it's a new comb. You should know why you need to protect queen cells, and of course, how to introduce queens and queen cells. If not, we've got other presentations that should show these, or we're hoping to make even more videos during the summer, which should cover some of these issues. So that's improving our bees and harvesting queen cells. Now the production of queens. So how are we going to do that? Well, if you've got swarm cells in a group A colony. Some of these little techniques that I'm going to tell you, you might struggle to pick them up straight away, but don't worry, because this this webinar is being recorded, so you can go back and you can watch the recording if indeed you want to. So let's say you've got swarm cells in a group A colony. So one of your good ones, you don't really want to waste them if you possibly can. So you could probably perform your normal swarm control method on them, whatever that is. If you want to take up a new one, you can do that. I've always used what I term the Wakeford method. It's an old method that was taught to me by a man called Wakeford. It hasn't got a name, so I gave it one. You'll catch that again on Cushman's website. Just put in Wakeford method and up it will come. You can then distribute queen cells, because you're going to be cutting them out anyway. Whenever you cut out queen cells, even if you don't think you're going to need them, make sure that you cut some of them out with a reasonable amount of comb behind, so that if you do actually need them, you've got them and you haven't squashed them. Like, I see a lot of people, they seem to enjoy squashing queen cells. I do if they're poor ones, or perhaps if they're two together, because generally if you get two together, it's difficult to separate them. Other than that, I certainly normally cut out three or four and then probably squash the rest, yeah. That's it, folks. That is really simple. So you've requeened a colony, possibly requeened other colonies, and you may well have got over the swarming problem in one hit. Now, if you've got still got cells in group A colony, here's an alternative. You can perform a swarm control that could be perhaps making up a two-frame nuke from a colony. And I've already told you about a two-frame nuke. Give it the queen from the colony, so you retain the queen. So this is a sort of modified version of artificial swarm, but it's not enough artificial swarm. Because that's in the same apiary, if you've got somewhere 3 miles away, then take it 3 miles away and you haven't got a problem. But most people in the group that I'm trying to address tonight are probably going to keep all their bees at home anyway. So in order to make sure you don't lose too many bees, if you either put it down fairly close to the ground or put a board up to the front of the nuke, shake two, three, four frames of bees from preferably open brood, unsealed brood, down at the front. The flying bees will fly home. The young bees will fly straight up. Will walk straight up into the box. If your box is a foot or so off the ground and you haven't got a board, don't worry about it. Just shake them straight down on the ground, and then get a stick and put that up from the ground where the bees are up to the front of the hive, and you'll find the bees will just walk straight up the stick. So that's also quite simple. And of course, what you've done is you've saved your old queen, the good one. You've requeened the parent colony, and if you want to, you've got the got spare queen cells for other colonies. So it's a bit of a modification on what I've just told you. Now, if you've got queen cells in both groups A and B, remove all the queen cells from group B colony and literally shake all the bees off the combs. Take the queen away as well, and replace with just one queen cell from group A. You can put more in if you want, but the problem with swarm cells is that you don't always know the age of them, and some can emerge probably 3 or 4 days before others. And the problem with that is if you get one emerged and another sealed one, the bees will more than likely swarm with the first one to emerge and leave the other one. So you're going to lose a swarm anyway. Don't forget to remove any subsequent emergency cells, because the queen has been taken away. And even though you can get a queen cell, they'll still put up 8, 10, perhaps 20 emergency cells. So I will go through 2 or 3 days later and take out all the emergency cells. If that queen cell you put in still hasn't emerged, do exactly the same 2 or 3 days later, because, of course, as soon as the emergency cells are sealed, there's a chance that the queen that's emerged from your chosen cell has gone out. So emergency cells in my book are badly a bit misunderstood. I think people just copy what they read, believe what they read, rather than actually looking and seeing what the bees are doing and what they're trying to achieve. And I don't know how many times I've heard it said that, oh, emergency cells always produce scrub queens. They can do if you don't know what you're doing, but if you know what you're doing, you can honestly get some really good queens from emergency cells. I don't let things drop if I can. And if I've got an opportunity to do a little experiment, I do it. And I've done this one several times. And here's my findings. And what I've done is I've dequeened a colony and then monitored it to see what happens, how many queen cells there are at 24-hour intervals, and when they've been put up. And I can tell you, folk, it is quite variable. And I wrote about findings of one of the experiments I did. It was on Patterson's page, BBK News, page 349, October 2019. So if you go on the BBK website, look for BBK News, October 2019, you'll find it. I've also basically copied it and put it on page 164 of Beekeeping Challenge What You're Told, which is a fairly recent book. There it is. And there's a whole load of stuff in there, similar to what I've just told you. Some of the stuff that we're told is fact as beekeeping, and all I've done is question it and give them my experiences. And I've had already quite a lot of people tell me that some of the things I've come up with they have as well. But that's the end of the commercial. I will tell you, though, that I've had some really good queens from emergency cells. If you take out the smaller ones and the poorer looking ones, I've had some really, really good queens from emergency cells. And if you think about it, the Miller method that a lot of people tell you to use, and the Alley method and several others of a similar nature, they are just emergency cells. That's all they are. So why people will tell you to or demonstrate the Miller method and then not support emergency cells, I've no idea. So here's one use of emergency cells. You get colony A with the queen. So dequeen it. And the best way I've found of doing that is taking the queen away. Don't put your boot on her, because she's going to be useful because you've got her in a group A. So what you can do is you can requeen a colony B with it. Immediately you've got an improvement, immediately. Or you can put her in a nucleus, perhaps a 2-frame nuke, exactly as I've told you. So what will happen? Queen cells will be built on worker larva. And again, I suggest strongly that you read what's in on Patterson's page or in the book, so you actually understand what may be happening rather than what you're told will happen. And for that reason, I'm suggesting that you don't cut out queen cells for 8 or 9 days. Don't cut them out after 3 to 5 days like we're normally told, because that, in my experiences, is when you get the poorer queen cells. Then you can either reduce to 1 if that's the only colony you want to requeen, or distribute those cells to other colonies. So there's another really simple way of producing queen cells. A modification of that is, again, make up a 2-frame nuke, give it a queen, shake bees in front of it, as I've told you, and then deal with the emergency cells however you like. So if you've only got one colony, perhaps, this is an excellent way of getting a queen in your and a second colony. But if you've got more than that, then just distribute the queen cells. So, folks, what I've just told you should satisfy many beekeepers. There's loads of other different ways of doing things. And I'm sure people are going to be emailing me and saying, well, what about so-and-so? Why didn't you say that? Well, it's because I've tried to keep things reasonably simple, especially perhaps for beginners, because there will be a lot of people watching the recording. So what have you got? You've got queens from local stock. You know they're the best ones that you have got access to. If you haven't got particularly good bees, then go and have a chat with somebody else and see if you can have a few larvae of theirs, or perhaps queen cells, or perhaps somebody kind enough to give you a queen. Certainly during the summer, most beekeepers have got spare queens. They've done a swarm control operation or whatever, and they've got good queens to spare. Because they're local, they should survive better than something that's been reared in, I won't name a country, but let's say a much warmer climate than we've got. You may well find they need less feeding as well, because a lot of the queens that you buy will probably come from exotic stock. They're very prolific queens, put up big colonies, and they just want a lot of food. And just because a colony is big doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get a lot more honey. Yes, you might in a good warm year, especially if the weather's or the climate is like they used to. But with our rather fickle climate, we can easily go a couple of weeks without nectar coming in. A strong colony, as I keep saying, if it's strong enough to collect 2 supers of honey, it's strong enough to eat it. Great thing is you've produced them. So that's where the satisfaction comes in. It is part of my management system. I'd like to see queen rearing, queen replacement, that sort of thing, as part of everybody's management system, because it is really simple, and it's something that I do really without thinking most of the time. But effectively, it could be just an extension of what you already do. So perhaps with your swarm control method, just expand it a little bit and start raising some queens with it. What you will be doing is contributing to the good drones that are flying in your area, rather than if you're buying something in from outside that doesn't suit your drones. Then the unsuitable drones will be mating with everybody else's and weakening them. And it will also add to your enjoyment. And as you probably know, I think beekeeping is fun. It should be anyway. So last opportunity is much more sustainable than buying queens, because in general, people who buy queens, in order to keep them reasonably similar, they've got to keep on buying them. This way, you can develop the bees in your area, in your own bees, and even if they put a ban on imports or whatever, I'm not suggesting they should or that they will. But if there was a ban on imports, you are self-sufficient. And that, to really, I think, is what beekeeping is all about. So when you've bred a queen, lays up like this, she's gone through a full brood cycle, everything's okay. You can clip a marker, although this one's only marked and not clipped. I think you can feel really satisfied, and you've got a good right to. So that's it, folks. Thanks very much. And as I already said once, beekeeping is fun. So any questions from that? Richard, your turn.
Super trooper. Okay. Thank you very much, Roger, for that. We've had quite a few questions coming. Let's have a look. So, can you make up a two-frame nuke with a frame from an A colony with a queen cell attached rather than make up a nuke and then add a queen cell?
Oh, yes. Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, of course you can. Excuse me, I'll just... oh, yes, yes, of course you can. It would... Yeah, if you're doing that, I wouldn't do a trick that I often do, which is put them in a position of another colony, because they might come in and tear the queen cell down. But yes, I've done it many times. Yeah,
yeah. Are you all right, Roger? We don't have to send out an SOS, do we?
Well, you can if you like. Yeah, it'd probably be the last one. My age.
Roger, when you cut out a queen cell and then place that cell into another colony,
yep,
how do you attach it to or house it into the frame?
Oh, if you've got a queen cell, I generally put them within the brood area if there is brood, or where the brood area would be if the queen hasn't been laying for 21 days. Combs with holes and gaps. I don't like combs that haven't got any, because I think those bees use those gaps for communication. So they can get through from one side of the comb to the other without having to go around the outside, over or underneath. So if I can find a hole, I would put it into there. If you notice at the front of a hive, there's usually a gap between the comb and the sidebar of the frame of about half an inch, three quarters of an inch, something like that. You usually get it at the front of the hive. I put them in there if I can. But you need to make sure that the bees can cover them. I wouldn't put them on food, and I have seen people put queen cells in food. What also you can do is, you can't do it very well with castellated spaces, but with basically all the other forms of frame spacing, you can move the frames apart just a little bit, and then just wedge the queen cell down between the top bars. If there's it obviously needs bees, combs well covered with bees. Can I go back? This is one of the problems, especially with beginners. Well, not just beginners. I've seen it in teaching apiaries and experienced beekeepers as well. I don't think I'd put a queen cell in for several hours, and the reason is it's not always easy to judge the age of the bees that you've moved. So if you get a warm day, you can end up with a lot more flying home than you think you have, and they could almost abandon the queen cell. So I would just add that.
I'm surprised, Roger, that you've not posted people to our latest video, which is introducing a protected queen cell into a colony. Because actually in there you do give some good tips on where to position the queen cell, and you actually show on the frame where the best places are.
The reason I didn't do it is because I thought it'd be good for you to do something.
I thought so. I thought that might
How about you doing it?
It will be in the video description at the end, so thank you for that. Next question was, does Roger promote drone foundation in A hives? So the hives that you say, that's an A, so a good colony. Do you put drone foundation in there?
Right. Yes, I do. I generally put one frame of drone in each colony. I say generally. And the reason I do that is because I mentioned that I've removed several hundred free living colonies. And this is only an estimate. It's not counting up cells or anything like that. I reckon that a normal colony will probably build about 10 to 15% area-wise drone drone comb. They don't use it all at the same time. That doesn't matter. Right. So, and where do they put it? They put it on the edge, either around the edge or down the bottom. So my simple mind tells me that that's roughly what they want. Now, one frame out of 11 frame box is roughly 10%. I know it's a shade less. So what I generally do is put a frame of drone comb, not the outside frame, but the next one in, usually. And what I find is that the bees don't chew down worker comb to build the drone, because of course what happens is, and everybody does it, in their brood frames they always put worker foundation. Well, not always, but most of them put worker foundation. They don't think about the drones. So of course what happens is the bees put what they want. Now if you give them what they want, you'll find that they won't chew down the worker combs so much. So yes, I actually put them in all colonies. Now there's something else I do, which I'm not sure if I've mentioned on some of the other webinars or not. but I do it because of the number of queens arise, the number of mating newts. You can get what I call mismating. So you can get a good queen mating with a poor drone. So they're pushing out all sorts of mixtures. Right. I keep those, and but I don't breed from them because they're pushing out decent drones. But what I tend to do, if I've got colonies that I would requeen anyway, what I tend to do is put one of the drone combs of an A colony in a B colony, and let that colony raise them and fly from there. If you put another drone comb in your A colony, the queen would go in and lay it up almost straight away, within a couple of 3 days. So the next round is going to be emerging within 2 or 3 days of each other. So that then will come out and it will go into one of your bee colonies to replace the drone comb that you put in last time, which the queen in the meantime would have laid in. So what happens is you get in those colonies, the bee colonies that you put the drone comb in, those queens don't lay very many drones. I haven't explained it very well.
No, I think that's good, because the colony that you're introducing the drone brood into doesn't need to produce any of its own drones. So
that's right. Yes. Yeah. You got it. Okay.
Yeah. So you reduce the number of bee colony drones that are out there mating with queens. which is your poorer stock. So that's I suppose you've got to be careful about varroa control in the one that you keep putting.
But it's no problem. The reason it's no problem is because, or at some stage, virtually all that comb is going to be sealed. So all you need to do is just uncap it. Well, not uncap it, but with a fork. If there's quite a heavy load, then just take it out, put it in the freezer, and then do that another couple of times, and it drops your varroa right down. If you've got virtually no varroa in, then leave it. Now, I heard from an Irish beaker a webinar a few weeks ago, and he was doing a similar thing to what I was doing. Not quite the same, but he was doing a similar thing. He was getting he wasn't calling them A colonies, but he was getting the good colonies, his breeder colonies, to raise queens to emerge in the poorer colonies. So he was making good use of the poorer colonies. And I'm doing effectively the same thing.
Right. Going back to way that you tracked your colonies and recorded them, somebody asks, you state that you grade your queens on both temperament and calmness. Can you explain the difference between the two in your eyes?
Oh, well, yeah, calmness is calmness on the comb. Temper is the temperament of the colony. So if they're stingy, let's say, and they're quite stingy, then they will get marked right down. Now, I have to say that the markings I use, nobody else will be able to understand. So it is rather a personal thing. So I think probably this is where local associations have got a bit of a role to play. That perhaps each local association could devise perhaps a scale of 1 to 5, 1 being awful, 5 being excellent, perhaps 4 acceptable, 3 average, you know, that sort of thing. And why? You've clearly got to demonstrate these things to people. I don't mean accidental stings, I mean aggressive stings. I mean, some of them aren't actually stingers. They just sort of annoying, and they fly around, and they're what one might term buzzers. But on the other hand, I went to one teacher in April on one occasion, and I hadn't been there for a week, and we were 50 yards away, and everyone else got booted up and suited up when they got out of the car. And of course, I walked down to the bees with Justin Veil, 50 yards away. I got 4 stings in my back.
Oh, man.
They were after me. So it'd be quite difficult for that group, because they'd all be on a minor scale.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Edward's got a good problem, really. How do you breed from a non-swarmy queen? So last year, out of 6 colonies, 1 showed no signs of swarming and produced a good crop and had good temper, but didn't produce any queen cells. So basically, is A colony. When does he remove the queen? At what time of year to be able to produce a mate?
So certainly I would do it as early as I could, because it depends on his area. He might have some mismatings. Well, if you do it early, you can do something about it. You can have another round of it. Now, what a lot of people don't seem to realise is that the swarmability of the, or in my experience, the swarmability of a colony of bees is in direct relationship to the number of queen cells that a colony will build at the time of swarming. The lower the number they build at the time of swarming, the less likelihood of swarming. The more they build, the more swarmy they're likely to be. Now, that also feeds through to emergency cells, because if you take a queen away from one of these colonies that is non-swarmy, you'll find they won't build very many queen cells, but they'll probably build enough. you know, they might only build half a dozen. And one issue with emergency cells is that sometimes you get a reasonable, well, a fair number that you can't use. So you might find there's 50% you can't use. Also, they do all sorts of things. They generally put two together. If that's the case, you cannot separate them, or very, very rarely. I've tried scalpels, I've tried razor blades. neither of which seem to work. You seem to cut into one cell or the other. It's not even worth messing about. You might just as well pinch out the worst one. But if you've got one that's in a difficult place to cut out, perhaps over a wire, which of course with an emergency cell is going to be a problem anyway. Swarm cells shouldn't be a problem because you can get behind it. But if it's immediately over a wire, and very often they do pick wires for some reason, and I don't know why, you've either got to cut to the wire, or that's fine, take the frame with the cell on it. So if he's got bees that are that good, then I would try and find a way of doing it. Another thing he could do would be to take the queen away from one of his poorer colonies and put a newish comb from his A colony, his good colony, into the one that he's taken the queen away from, and then let and raise the queens for him.
So that's a good tip. Yeah, he's from Stafford. So, yeah, put in your A colony frame of young larvae into one of the B colonies that are likely to raise quite a few cells, but mark the frame that he takes from the A colony and that he puts in his B colony.
Well, it should be pretty obvious, because once you take the queen away from the A colony, you're probably best leaving it 7, 8, 9 days. Then take out all the emergency cells, shake all the bees off, look everywhere. So you remove all the emergency cells so they can only build on that one frame that he puts in there.
Okay. Next question was, noticed locally that there have been many dead outs to what they think is varroa bombs. Would you ever use a Nicot or Nicot system to increase the number of queen cells? If not, is there a way of maximising queen production?
Queen production, you're back to what I just said, because if you've got a swarmy colony, they will produce more queen cells. And I think this is some of the reasons why you very often get online and you see great big frames of queen cells. I saw one the other day with 64, I think it was 64 or 68. You probably wouldn't get that in this country, because the colonies in general aren't as big, and they're not so swarmy either. The man says dead outs, varroa. Probably. Whether it's the so-called varroa bomb or not, I don't know. It'd be very difficult to tell. Certainly, I would check the combs over to make sure there's nothing else going on before putting anything else in.
Okay, okay. Requeening an aggressive colony? Is there a way that you would suggest that?
Let's go back to basics. You've got to make sure it's aggressive first. I've been called out to quite a lot of colonies that are supposedly aggressive. When I get there, they're absolutely fine. So I say to the beekeeper, look, you handle the next one, and you find the other. Don't use smoke, or don't use it in time. They're rough hand and that sort of thing. So you've actually got to make sure that it is a genuine aggressive colony. Now that might be easier to tell if there are several colonies and the same person is handling all of them. If let's say you've got four colonies Three are fine, and one gets fired up, and the chances are it's the bees, which of course could be F2 aggression, which does happen a lot. I think a lot more than people expect. Depending on the situation, if you've got supers on, I think probably the best thing to do is make up a little nuke. Well, I'd actually need to see the situation, Richard. If you can't get the supers off, then that is real aggression and viciousness. And I have to say that over nearly 60 years of beekeeping and handling a lot more colonies than most people, I think I walked away from a colony no more than 10 times simply because it doesn't matter what you do, just cannot get into it. I've probably got a different situation than most. But if it is quite tetchy and you can still get into it, try to get the queen if you can. If you can't, they won't allow you to, then probably the thing to do is one evening, smoke them up, smoke the bees, stuff up the entrance, move that colony away. You probably need to do it when the weather's good, and the weather forecast for the following day is good. In its place, put a smallish nuke, which could come from one of the other colonies. At the back end of the following day, you should have lost most of your flying bees. And they're the ones in general are going to be aggressive. So if you can requeen then that will be okay. If you're genuinely struggling, if you've got a queen cell, and this is something I mentioned somewhere else, and it's something that the old beekeepers told me when I started, if you've got a queen cell, if you protect it and you can actually get the supers off, just put the queen cell down between the combs. You don't have to take the combs out. There's somewhere you can get a queen cell in, a protected queen cell, and I suggest that you do it with silver foil, as I show in that video. In fact, that might be where I mentioned it, but I can't remember. Anyway, in my experience, in about 60 to 80% of the cases, the bees will take that as a supersedure. So they'll let the young queen emerge, go out and get mated, and the old queen will disappear. Now, I knew of this a long time ago, but just recently, somebody showed me a New Zealand website saying that the New Zealand commercial beekeepers use that method for requeening as a matter of course. And in fact, what they've done is they've taken one of my pictures off Dave Cushman's website, and they didn't give me credit for it.
That's a good technique, though, using a protected queen cell to induce supersedure.
Yeah, it does work, but I mean, you wouldn't pass a BBK exam by giving that answer. But it's one of the old tricks that works. Yeah, most of the time.
Question about drawing out combs. So in the Patterson unit, you draw brood combs out over a queen excluder. Do you move the frames around in the top box to ensure that all the frames are drawn fully?
Not usually. If you've got to do that, you'll end up with not all of them being drawn properly. What I tend to do is do it early in the season. But I'm in an all-sea rape area, and on a strong colony with a good flow, I can get one of those boxes filled out. And of course, they're going to get extracted straight away or fairly quickly, so there's no granulation. I've then got a box full of frames that I can use during the summer. Now, you can use these frames for anything. You can use it for building up nukes. doing a comb change, or demarie, or anything of that nature.
Excellent. Well, time is slipping through our fingers, so we'll make this the last one. Transportation of queen cells over distance?
What do you mean by distance?
The person doesn't say, I presume, from one apiary to another, perhaps more than 3 miles.
Oh yeah, half an hour or so, you're going to be okay. The older they are, the safer you are. It's generally the younger ones that either get damaged or they get chilled. But if they're sort of almost fully developed, ready to go, and the bees have started thinning down the end, you can get away with them quite easily. In fact, the old guy that did most of, he taught me much of what I knew in the early days. He never wore a veil, no gloves or anything like that. He just wore an old cap, and he put queen cells in his cap 9 o'clock in the morning, and he was still using them 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and they were still emerging. But what you need to do, I think, is keep them upright. I would probably put them in something, let's say like tissue paper, bit of kitchen roll or something of that nature, just to keep them upright. And if you can keep them warm, so much the better. But certainly during the summer, I've kept bees and queen cells in front of a car. Don't put them in the sun, because I very soon die. But I'd put them in front of a car for an hour, 2 hours. And if they're within the last 24 hours, they're usually okay. But, you know, from a beginner's point of view, a small beekeeper's point of view, the less tripwires you can put down, the better. So try and do the best you possibly can with them.
Excellent. Well, that brings us to the end of the questioning this evening. Roger, thank you very much for a very interesting talk on small-scale small-scale queen rearing.
Sure, one life from the hive.
Yeah. Useful for people who potentially haven't been doing it for very long. It's an easy way to get started in queen rearing and even queen selection. So selecting from your best colonies and producing queens, and best of all, you get those local queens, and it doesn't cost you anything, because the bees are going to be doing it anyway. So we just utilize that. Excellent. Thank you very much, Roger. We'll leave it there for this evening. We've got some more webinars coming up in the pipeline. Let's just have a look. We've got the wax production and replacing old comb. We've got an introduction to Lum Valley community beekeepers. There's the moving up the step into commercial, semi-commercial beekeeping, and beekeeping, can we make it pay? All of those, the dates are on beekeeping.events. So if you're running any beekeeping events, don't forget that you can put your event on there so you can avoid clashes with other organisations. That's a really useful tool. Our YouTube channel is absolutely crammed full of different videos that are really useful for beginners and those that are moving up into intermediate and advanced. And if you're not yet a member, please consider subscribing to BIBBA. We rely on our members' funding to be able to do all that we do. So we would really appreciate it if you would think about spending the £20, which is what the cost of a queen, Roger. Roger's already given you 20, 40, 60 quid there in queen cells from today's talk. So feel free to check out the membership page of the BIBBA website. But that's all from us this evening. We will see you next time. Good night from me, and it's a good night from him.
Yeah, good night, everybody.